Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. Here we are, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. A great, great episode this week. As I've said many times leading into the month of December, all the episodes in the month of December are related to music nonprofits, art nonprofits, nonprofits that use music to benefit nonprofits. It's a grand cornucopia of music and nonprofits this month here on 25 O'Clock. And one of the reasons I'm doing that for, I'm doing it for many reasons, but one of the reasons is because it's end of the year, it's holiday time, and people's thoughts more often turn to charitable giving. Good. I'm glad your thoughts turn to charitable giving at some point in the year. End of year, it's a great time to donate to any of the fantastic music nonprofits here in Philadelphia. I don't know why I'm out of breath. I'm out of breath because I'm so excited about the music nonprofits that you can donate to. That's why I'm winded. Anyway, thrilled as heck to highlight this week the nonprofit Rock to the Future, a music nonprofit program that brings free music after-school programs and some in-school programs as well to the youth of the Philadelphia school system. They're an outstanding organization. I got to talk to Josh and Jess Kraft, the two founders of the organization. It was great to talk to them. We'll talk more about Rock to the Future in just a moment. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, I highly recommend you check out 25oclockpod.com. Everything's there. All the episodes for streaming and for downloading. You can sign up for the mailing list. I send out an email every time there's a new episode. You can hook up with us on social media, on Twitter, on Instagram. And you can check out the Friends and Neighbors page. It's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you're listening to an episode, you like what you hear, you want to support it, whatever it is, could be an artist, could be a band, could be a music nonprofit. If you want to, I've made it so easy for you. Go to the Friends and Neighbors page and click away. Just click away. Just click, 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 click all the live long day. You'll be happy. I'll be happy. Everyone will be happy. 25oclockpod.com. All right. Well, before we get too much into the Rock to the Future talk and all that, I did get to attend the For the Music benefit last night at the Story Factory up on North 5th Street in Philadelphia. It was a great time. Saw four outstanding bands. Saw Arch Palatine. Saw the Tisbury's. Saw Stereo League. And the standout for me was absolutely Koof Knots and Christina Lise. Those of you not living under a rock know who Koof Knots is in Philadelphia. Outstanding MC and hip-hop artist. And Christina Lise is a classically trained harpist and an amazing singer. And when those two things go together, so think of it like hip-hop beats, sort of a hip-hop vibe, and then really ethereal harp, and Christine's got amazing vocals, and they had a flautist play with them too, which was awesome. Some guy got up and played harmonica. It was a great show. They were the standout for me. Everyone was outstanding, but I was very, very excited to see Koof and Christina Lise. Great, great show. Thank you to Sean Timmons and Helm Creative Studios for putting the show together. It benefited iCreate and Philly Cam, two outstanding music and media nonprofits here in Philadelphia, so I was very, very glad that I got to go to that. Perhaps that's why I'm slightly out of breath, because I spent a lot of the show talking to people that I haven't seen in a while. I knew a lot of the bands, I knew a lot of the people there, a lot of talk, and you know when you're trying to talk at a loud show, and you're all talking real loud at each other, and then I get home, and I sound bad. So perhaps that is why I'm out of breath. But anyway, great show. Great job, everyone involved. Awesome space, too, at the Story Factory. Really, really cool. Don't sleep on that. Go check that out on the interwebs, the Story Factory PHL. Go see it. But anyway, let's talk about Rock to the Future. Let's talk about Josh and Jess. They founded the organization 12 years ago. Some things to know about Rock to the Future. First off, you can find them on the internet, rocktothefuture.org. You can also go to rocktothefuture.bandcamp.com. That's where they put up all the student work. Students make original songs. They record them. They have opportunities to go and record in professional recording studios, places like the Headroom up in Fishtown. And they get a chance to play live in great venues like Johnny Brenda's and World Cafe Live. But yeah, check out both those sites right there. But like I said, 12 years ago, they started the organization. It started by serving, I think, just 13 students, and now they serve hundreds of students a year. They're in over 12 school locations in the city. There are no cost to students at all. No auditions either. They're not trying to gauge anyone's, you know, musical ability. If you're interested, that's enough. You can come and avail yourself of Rock to the Future. All the instruments and supplies are provided, and it's a very student-driven group, and they focus on peer collaboration, they focus on live performance, they focus on youth being able to make original work, things like that. Outstanding organization. You can go to rocktothefuture.org and you can donate as an individual. You can do workplace donations, workplace giving, instrument donations. All the information's there at rocktothefuture.org. And very special this month, it's the end of the year. They have a $50,000 match. So if they can raise 50K in donations by the end of the year, someone is going to match that. So if there was ever a time to donate some cash to Rock to the Future, do it now. Go to rocktothefuture.org. And let's get to it. Let's get to my conversation with Josh and Jess. I've known Josh for years, as it comes up in the conversation. This is my first chance of really getting to know Jess, and she was the first person to come up with the idea for Rock to the Future, and Josh got on board right away like a good, supportive, awesome dude that he is. So enough about that. Let's get into it. Let's get to my conversation with Josh and Jess Kraft, founders of Rock to the Future, here on 25 O'Clock. Right off the bat, Josh, I know your story a little bit of kind of like where you came from and, you know, your involvement in the community. So I want to start with Jess. Jess, where are you from originally?
Upper Darby Township. So I went to Upper Darby High School. It's just outside of the city, right outside of West Philly.
Yeah. And what were your sort of early experiences in music? Because obviously you come at this as a music lover and as a fan and as a musician too. Do you play?
I do. Yeah. So I, in Upper Darby, we just had a really robust music programs from elementary school through high school. So I started violin in third grade, and then clarinet, saxophone. And then in seventh grade, I switched to drums, and then I was in the drum line. Upper Darby has a very competitive marching band and drumline program. So that was basically how I spent like my middle school and high school life. Band Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, working Tuesday, Thursday, Sunday. And, you know, during the school day, had like concert band and wind ensemble and, you know, orchestra. And it was cool. Like, you got to leave enrichment class or like cafeteria to go and do band. But so for me, that was really the access, having that access, because otherwise I don't know if I would have had the opportunity, because of, you know, music can be very expensive to have the chance to participate in.
Oh, certainly, certainly. And I think we're all about the same age, and I think we all benefited from sort of the last real available like music and like robust music and arts in schools, because it's not just underserved communities. It's not just what people think of as like city, you know, city schools and all that. Cause from what I understand, it's sort of across the board. Something happened in the early millennium where like suddenly schools just didn't want to put the money or the resources into it anymore.
I think a lot of that has to do with maybe like the changes in like the education, like the core curriculum and schools needing to prove that kids are learning and taking standardized tests. And so there's so much pressure on teachers and on schools to have their classes and their schools meet, you know, this whatever minimum standards that the states are putting forward. So then they're taking resources away from other things because they're just not seen as being as valuable on paper for, you know, funding needs and teachers showing that they're doing their jobs well. So I believe Upper Darby, like they still have a pretty robust program. They have some like pretty high profile folks like Tina Fey went to that high school. And so she, you know, does things. But I mean, so when we're talking about Philadelphia, like there was already so many funding inequities just because of the setup between the state and then the city. And so when budget cuts are happening, it's just like totally decimating those additional opportunities.
And Josh, you and I have definitely talked before about this just as people, but where are you from originally? You're from Jersey, right?
No.
Oh, I'm wrong. Okay. Never mind.
currently in Jersey, but originally I was born in Las Vegas.
Oh.
Yeah, sunny Las Vegas, you know, and then moved over to Jersey, I guess, for like a little bit, and then settled in Honesdale. It's like north of Scranton. So, you know, the show The Office and everything. Yeah. So. But Honesdale is more boonies, you know, more out there, you know, or about like 30-40 minutes away from Scranton. So so that's where I came from, was middle school and high school and all that.
I know you've always been interested in music, but this is something you had told me before, that like there was a whole different trajectory that you had sort of thought your life was going to be when you were a young person, right?
Oh yeah, studying to be a doctor, believe it or not, in high school and everything. And you know, all while I was doing that, I was putting on concerts, I was in bands, I was writing music, you know, I was in the choir. I had an opportunity when I was younger to be like on a Broadway production of Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. So I always like really loved music and art, and you know, made a last minute decision to go for music industry at Drexel. So really you know, kind of shifted my whole life right there. But it was, you know, kind of had to take a deeper dive into like what's going to make me happy, not what's going to make me money and what's going to make me financially stable in life, you know, or comfortable, you know. But ultimately that led me down to going to Drexel for music industry. And all the while I was like teaching, you know, music, even in high school. I was a guitar teacher. And then that, you know, I continued that into college. You know, I taught school rock and a lot of private students, as well as other music schools that I'll teach at.
Because that's how you and I met in Philadelphia. Originally, is what we determined, is that we had probably met like 10 or 15 years before I even got involved with Rock to the Future, because you used to put on shows at the Mill Creek Tavern in West Philadelphia, and I definitely played a couple of at least two or three of those shows.
Who was your band?
We were at the time, we might have been called Confusion About Weather at the time. Which is a bizarre name for a band. We would end our career as The Way Home. That was something. But I remember definitely, Josh, I think probably one of the first times I met you was like us, Bells, 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 and like Illinois or something like that. I seem to recall that being a show I may have played at the Mill Creek.
Yeah, that was a lot of college. Meeting Jess and stuff, she came out to one of my band shows, and I started putting on concerts at her house. So I would you know, put on concerts like anywhere and everywhere you know, that would allow. So, you know, we would do shows, Mill Creek, World Cafe Live, Kung Fu Necktie, Jess's house, you know, a warehouse, you know, just like all unique spaces, and all different types of shows, punk shows, rock shows, indie, classical shows. We did look kind of like everything, you know.
So that's how you two met? Like, Jess, you went to a show and Josh was running it, and then there we have it.
She got dragged to a show.
Oh, okay.
My friend took me to the show. Yeah, Josh was playing the B team at that time. I think it was the Bees and the Birds.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. had changed their band name to the B team. And that was at the Khyber, when the Khyber was
downstairs. Yeah.
You know, the old Khyber. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What did you think about it the first, like, because you say you got dragged, so clearly like going into it perhaps your expectations were low.
Well, it was fun. I mean, the bass player in Josh's band, Chrissy, I grew up with Chrissy, so it was really funny because we went to the Khyber and saw the band, and then we're just hanging out, you know, outside, and Chrissy and I realized that we had grown up together. Her mom actually babysat me when we were toddlers, and Yeah, I don't know. And then started talking to Josh, and then
And then
I don't
here we
know.
are.
And
And
here
then
we are.
here we are. And then somewhere in there you started a nonprofit and brought and this time you dragged Josh along.
I dragged Josh along. Yeah. So I went to school for business administration and economics. So again, it's kind of one of those things where it's like my parents, they really encouraged me to go to school for something that I would have like a stable career in. And then after college, I worked at Janie Montgomery Scott as a performance analyst. I was studying for my Series 7 broker's exam. But I was also volunteering with Big Brother, Big Sister. I had a little sister, volunteering with Habitat for Humanity, doing other community work, and then had this opportunity to apply for $15,000 in seed funding to start this concept of let's have completely free music programs. Let's have it be like instruments that kids can get super excited about. Let's really make it about original songwriting. And we can use this as a way to get them in the door. And then we can provide like educational support and safe spaces after school. And then we started with 13 kids in the Kensington Fishtown area. And I did the business stuff, still do most of the business related things. And Josh is the music person.
Josh is the guy who never stops moving, from what I've observed.
I mean Rock of the Future, it's 12 years old this year. We are expecting to serve more than 600 students this year, which is just unbelievable. And we're working in, you know, public schools, community locations, the Juvenile Justice Service Center, so with incarcerated youth. And it's just been incredible. But I mean, yeah, it's been a really wild 12 years of just the grind. And doing whatever needs to get done.
Well, what was the impetus for you to even like go seek out that seed money right there? Because it sounded like you had a pretty sweet gig right there. You know, Janie Montgomery Scott, you were studying for Series 7. You were on your way to kind of having that be, you know, what you did. What was kind of the spark that made you, I mean, for lack of a better term, kind of completely shift your focus at a time in your career life where probably everybody thought you were crazy?
Yeah, well, with Big Brother, Big Sister, which is a really incredible program. So I think a lot of people are familiar with it, but, you know, you can get matched with a teen and there's you're mentoring them and just providing them with like a positive relationship and do activities together. So my younger sister loved music. She didn't have access to it in school. We would go to Pennypack Park and I would show her how to play guitar, and she had a great voice. But then I really kind of saw a lot of the struggles that students were going through and then that families were going through, and lived in different areas of the city. So lived in North Philly and West Philly, and just recognizing the lack of access and the deep poverty, and then just kind of reflecting on how meaningful music was in my own childhood. I mean, at the same time with Janie Montgomery Scott, like it's a great gig and great company, but there's also the recession and people are, you know, you just kind of reflect on like, what's the important things in life and what do you want to be doing and how are you contributing back to the world and what are you spending your time doing? And I decided that that wasn't something that I wanted to doing. And then Josh was, willing to jump on this journey, and you know, because it wasn't like we just like kind of had all these side gigs and hustles and catered on the weekends and did promotions, and like instead of going to Thanksgiving the one year, we both worked like Harry Potter promotional events to just, you know,
oh, interesting,
make money, pay the bills.
Yeah.
We did focus groups, probably everything outside of maybe like medical studies to pay the bills while trying to, you know, start up this organization.
Yeah. That had to have been a fascinating conversation that first evening, Josh, where Jess comes home from the firm and says, you know what? What if we started a music nonprofit in our kitchen or whatever? Like what if we started this out of the house? Like obviously you have been on board like 100% since the beginning, but that had to have been a very interesting shift in just like how you guys were going to go about your lives, like going forward.
Well, I think that, you know, like what Jess was saying with the gig life that we were, you know, in. So I'm pretty Willing to, at that point in my life, you know, just willing to jump into anything. You know, me and Jess played in bands. Well, you know, I mean, some of those promo gigs, I mean, I remember Jess was like downtown in Philadelphia and I'm dressed up as like a crash test dummy handing out like flyers for like the new Crash movie, you know, like we were just in this space in our life where we were just, you know, really just excited to try something out new, you know. I think we were like touring too, you know, our band and things like that too. So we were just like 24/7 nonstop working and hustling. So I think that ask of let's start something up, you know, was an easy, like, yeah, I'm into that. You know, that sounds great, you know? And I don't think we realized the impact when we first started, that it was going to have on things and just kind of snowballed, and got bigger and bigger every year. I mean, the first two or three years, you know, like we didn't take any, you know, income from it, like ourselves, like we didn't pay ourselves a salary or anything like that. So we still worked, you know, four or five other jobs, you know, to keep it going, you know. But then by the third year, you know, we got a big enough, we're the beneficiaries of an event, and that kind of like put us to the point where we could finally move into the space where, you know, we can just focus on that, you know, which was great.
Yeah. What were those first few years like? Was it pretty, it was just the two of you and like maybe some volunteers that you had kind of gotten to get on board?
We paid other folks to work. But yeah, the first year we had like 13 students. The second year I think we had like 20 students. People were getting paid like $10 an hour to come in and teach a class, you know, a group drum class, and then like and band practices and stuff. So I'm really proud of where we're at right now with being able to provide great compensation to our music instructors and stuff, because I think that that's something that is just absolutely needed. But, you know, we kind of made do with what we had, with what we had at that time, and people were willing to give their time because they believed in the mission and in providing access. And it was just working, you know, in Kensington in the one location. And when we received the large grant from Delaware Investments, which is now Macquarie Group, so that was over $200,000. And that was through my relationships with Jenny Montgomery Scott, actually. So it is really interesting how that corporate job tied into kind of the pivotal impact of like being able to get Rock to the Future going. So that is what started to allow us to bring on like, yeah, paid team members and start to grow the programs, and then started to branch out into other locations. And then suddenly people were calling us and asking for programs and can you come to our school? Can you come to our neighborhood? And I think we also started to really define like, what is this program about? And like, how are we meeting the needs of the different communities that we are now working in?
You seem to have shifted, not shifted over the years, but you sort of keep tacking on like new things that you do. Things that obviously serve the mission, but you keep broadening the mission every year. Because as it originally started, it was more, you know, music-centric based and music in the school space. But you guys do stuff with trauma response and nonviolence, and there's career and college prep, which is like a whole part of it as well, which, you know, just if you looked at the name of the organization, you wouldn't immediately think that like that was part of it. How did these things all kind of like come on one at a time?
From the start, the concept, I guess, was like really that music bringing youth in the door and then being able to provide tutoring and educational support. But I think it was like as the kids were getting older, it was primarily sixth grade students, but then as they're getting older and then they get into high school and it's like, oh my gosh, like they need help with that transition. And then they're getting older and it's like, oh my gosh, they're going into college and or trade school. And there's not a lot of resources in the schools. And for most of the students, they're the first generation graduates attending higher post-secondary education. And it was just a need. It was a need that we saw. And it was something that we felt was important. And so similar to bringing trauma-informed approaches into all of our programs is as we started to work in other areas of the city, and then also just really reflecting on how can we better serve the kids that we're working with, that was a need. So we changed the program design. We started providing training. Same thing with like restorative practices. We used to be much more, you know, oh, if you didn't practice, then you're in trouble or whatever. But really changing like the mindset of that, of like, we're trying to provide a space that is really like student driven, focused on like their voice and what they're interested in and how, what they would like to create. And then infusing like all of these really necessary youth development strategies to just strengthen that. I'm really proud, like this year, we had the resources to bring on part-time, actually like a social worker type of position. So like now she's meeting regularly with students and being able to connect families to like other things like housing, food, mental and physical health resources, kind of whatever other things kids and teens and their families need in order to thrive. So it's like not like we have to do everything ourselves, but we build a really, really strong like partnership base so that way we can provide other resources.
Yeah, you're like an avenue in, and then once they're in, it's like, boom, look at all this stuff that is available to you. And I'm sure you never would have imagined in the first couple of years that you were starting that you would be able to provide, again, not just like great music instruction and a really cool place for kids to hang out who, you know, who want to do these things, but you moved up into even a higher level.
Yeah, because I think like in the first couple of years when kids were graduating, because since we started having graduates, like every student had from our after school programs have graduated and pursued college or trade school, which is really incredible. Because, you know, for example, like Kensington High School that we work in, it's like a 61% graduation rate, and then 21% of the student body pursues college. So for us working in a similar school and or working in that school and having 100% of students go into college or trades, you can really see the impact. But we didn't want it to be just like a checkbox where we're pushing kids into some type of after high school program and really wanting to focus on like, what are the different skills? What are the different desires? What are the different needs? How are they kind of building their own dreams? And we're providing like the support system for them to get there. So that way, it's really about supporting like that current well-being, but also thinking about, you know, what can happen for them after high school, after college, further into their lives, that we can create like joyful and well-adjusted and happy people, wherever that may be.
Talking about like sort of the shifting in 2020 as well, because like, you know, schools changed completely for that year. Everything we did changed completely for that year. And you brought on this sort of great digital virtual classroom situation. Whose idea was that? Like, what I mean, because obviously it all happened to us so suddenly, so like, you know, you had to come up with what you were going to do. How did that kind of come about?
Well, you know, once everything shut down, all of our in-person programs shut down, you know, and you know, we had to figure out a way to, you know, switch over what we were doing in a similar way, you know, virtually, and keep these kids engaged and find some other avenues for kids to socialize and you know, pick up an instrument every, you know, once a week at least, you know. We started the virtual programs I started a pilot with my family, you know, like doing guitar lessons, you know, with my mom and Jess's mom too, not, you know, for Rock to the Future, but just kind of experimenting with how we're going to do this via, you know, virtually with Zoom and things like that, you know. We you know, started bringing back some instructors and started to do like a ton of, you know, getting together with them to figure out what kind of classes are going to work in this kind of setting. And, you know, it was a lot of like trial and error, you know, but I think there was some really positive things that came out of us doing virtual lessons. And during that time too, we got a ton of instruments. We got like, I think everyone was just like looking around in their house and like, oh, I have a guitar, I have a drum set, I don't play this, so I want to get rid of it. So we got tons and tons of instruments, and that kind of led us to a problem that we were having, is that we were just having so many instruments, we didn't know where to put them. So we're, you know, we provided all those instruments to the students. So, you know, we would go out and we would drive around you know, once a month and just drop off guitars, keyboards, drum sets, you know, all these different types of instruments. So through the virtual, it was kind of neat because I think we realized there's certain kids in different areas of the city that maybe, you know, we could use this as a way to identify students for future programs and like areas like West Philly or different areas of the city that like, you know, we could be bringing in programs to the kids that were just tuning in virtually, you know. So I think there's a lot of like benefits to going virtual for a bit. It was definitely a big lift. And I think that we worked super duper hard to make sure that, you know, the kids have had an avenue to connect every week and to, you know, create music and to share, you know, in like a showcase every term. Yeah. I think it was a lot of fun, but, you know, now that we've shifted back to in person, it's been, you know, times a thousand. You know, we've had a lot more sites, and I think that there's a lot of things we've learned from virtual. You know, knowing that we can do it too is a big thing, you know, if we ever have to again.
And you sort of kept it going even like as you started to get back into your in-person programming, which I thought was great because you did learn that lesson, which is like, wow, we can actually reach so many more people this way. And I just like, and that's when I got involved with you guys, just volunteering and doing one-on-one production stuff. You introducing me to Soundtrap as a program sort of changed how I do things going forward. That's my sole writing tool now because it's so fast.
Yeah. Yeah, it is wild. It's a really cool program.
I think Josh is like almost downplaying like how much work he even spent though going to the virtual year, because like the programs, the school shut down like I think it was March 13th or something, and then by like April 15th we had launched our virtual programs because wow. We had previously been using like GarageBand on iPads and needing to figure out like, oh my gosh, the kids are getting Chromebooks from their schools, so like you can't download things, there's restrictions. So Josh figured out the Zoom, how to use Zoom. He figured out like how like to switch over to Soundtrap. He delivered 250 instruments to kids and teens houses throughout Philadelphia. So he's really the one that did that stuff. And then so I guess, and then we served like 500 students the virtual program year. So it was really, I don't know. I just want to give Josh a shout out because I feel like he's like being a little bit humble and then downplaying how much energy went into that year, particularly then when like, you know, you're managing like all of the other stress that you're also personally feeling from a worldwide pandemic. Coming back to in-person, July 2021 was incredible. And being in person, there's just, virtual is great if that's necessary, but when you're playing music and when you're working with youth, that opportunity to be in a space together, nothing can be replicated when you're doing it virtually. We put the virtual programs on hiatus actually in April. So to really focus on the in-person partnerships, because there's just such a need for in-person positive spaces throughout the city. Because of that, like the in-person programs have grown to more than a dozen locations now.
Yeah, you kicked your mobile music lab up a level too. Even just in the little bit of time in between when I last was involved with you, there's a lot. You're out in a lot more spaces than you were even a year ago.
That's been a lot of the work that I'm doing this year. Is just, you know, there's such a demand for it now, you know, now that we're back in person. And you know, it's interesting too, because there was a lot of like people that reached out about mobile music before the pandemic, you know, like right before it. And, you know, the pandemic hit, we switched to virtual. And then then once we came back, I reach back out to those people and they're like, yeah, sure. You know, we still would love to have music now more than ever. So it's cool. It's neat connecting back with some of them. And then there's a lot of other new requests too as well. But, you know, one of the sites that we're going to be going into in 2 weeks, they you know, like while talking to them. It's so neat because they don't have a budget for music. They haven't had music in over a decade. And, you know, you can just see in the, like, we went around and talked to the kids, and you can see just in their eyes, like, how excited they are to get music coming into their school. So yeah, we've been doing group guitar classes, music production classes as well, and ukulele classes too. So those are the three ones that we're doing a lot of, but we also offer like choral ensemble too. But the partnerships have expanded a lot. We're in a lot of charter schools and parochial schools as well as public schools, some of which that don't even have music programs. So it's neat. It's nice to be able to provide that to the schools, as well as the juvenile justice centers. That's been new this past year.
Yeah, I was about to ask. That sounds like a new thing, right? That you guys are getting involved in that avenue right there. How's that been sort of manifesting itself right off the bat?
We have worked with almost since the beginning, maybe not the very beginning, but probably since 2012, we've had students in our programs that were in reentry programs. So we had worked for a decade or so with youth that were in the reentry or the diversion system. But when Juvenile Justice Services Center, they reached out to us and they were interested in bringing our programs in, and we had not really had the resources or the staff or the bandwidth to be able to do that prior to 2021. And we had the opportunity. They were interested in working with us. We had the staff, we had the resources to be able to do that. And so we started with one group there and have since doubled that group, doubled the number of students that we're serving in the Juvenile Justice Service Center. We also have other diversion organizations reaching out to us that we're looking forward to starting partnerships with. And so one of our big initiatives now is, how can we strengthen the pipeline for when youth are reentering, to have spaces throughout the city that they can get involved with, but then also how are we using our other partnerships of resources to provide like work opportunities for these young people, ongoing mentorship, educational opportunities, because the music is the bridge in order to provide these other necessary support systems.
What's a metric of success for that? I mean, other than like, you know, these kids not ending up back in the system again, or should I say a better way to frame that question is, what have you seen happening just in this last year of you working more directly with a group to do these kind of services?
The center that we work in, for example, is built for 180 teens, and they have more than 220 teens in the facility right now, which is really just, you know, heartbreaking. And there's even discussions now of them transporting the young people to Texas because they have more space there. So that's just like,
I just read something about that in Billy Penn or HYY recently about that very subject right there, about how, yeah, it's set for X number of kids, and of course they have way more.
Yeah, to send them to another state. I mean, it's devastating already that you have youth that are in, you know, in jails and in prisons, and then to send them thousands of miles away where they can't be near their families and just the other supports and stuff. So I guess one of our hopes is that we can reduce recidivism for when youth are coming out, that we're providing that support system. The teens. The greatest need is that they want to stay on the right path, but they're looking for employment, wages, and then positive spaces and peer groups that are supportive of those goals. And so we can provide some of those things ourselves, and then we can use our partnership base to connect them with other resources. If we're able to then also have the youth, you know, join our existing like really comprehensive after school programs, then we can even provide like the things that we do around like professional pathways, like college and trade school visitations. We have a new partnership actually, where one of our partners is going to pay for the cost for students to receive certifications in trades. It's really amazing.
Oh, cool.
And then we've also grown like our own higher education scholarship fund to be able to provide each graduating student from our Kensington and Germantown locations with a MacBook and a scholarship, and then help them also with like other financial aid needs. So we have like different levels of programs that are, you know, different commitment levels and different levels of support that we can provide ourselves. But now that our programs in Kensington and Germantown are staffed, are back in person, are thriving, we're really able to focus on other initiatives. And so a lot of that has to do with the mobile music programs and expanding access, expanding offerings, and then really strengthening that pipeline for youth when they're coming in out of the facilities.
All this from a music program, which is like, and when you think about it, and as you explain it, it's sort of a no-brainer right there. You're just like, well, of course these things would then follow, and you guys as an organization getting involved in these other more diverse things, like it makes sense when you explain it. But when you think about it, you're just like, wow, just from an after-school rock band program.
The other partnerships that Josh is in the middle of building are like with the Level Before Youth are in the Juvenile Justice Service Center. So prevention, intervention services. So that way we can break some of that before, you know, it gets to the point where youth are being incarcerated.
What's that looking like, Josh, on your end?
So we're looking at providing like a music production class to some of the students. It's in the Germantown area. It should be starting up possibly before January. We're still negotiating dates and stuff like that. But yeah, we're going to be bringing in music production to the students. So a lot of them, you know, because they run an after-school program that the kids are court ordered to, attend every day. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I think it's going to be a great experience for the students. And we're excited to be all part of it.
And it's not like you have to reinvent the wheel for it, because you already do this. You've been providing, you know, music production, instrument instruction, all that for, like I said, well over a decade. So you get to go to these groups and be like, look, when you said you're ready to start even before January, and I thought to myself, I go, that's like a month from now. Like, wow. But you can hit the ground running, and you've proven yourself for well over a decade, and you guys have dialed this in and, you know, gone through all the challenges. It's like, not to equate it like a business, but it's like a business that's reached that long where now you get to specialize and sort of hone instead of having to constantly just reinvent like what it is that you do at any given moment. I know that's something that nonprofits can, it's a trap you can fall into as a nonprofit where you can chase funding for the sake of funding instead of like, no, wait, we actually do that. Or no, wait, we would actually be good at that, type of thing.
It's been like, yeah, like really intentional. We do like strategic planning. The students and our partners and parents and everybody in the team, we're all involved in like the strategic planning process. So we've been really careful about not growing too fast and wanting to do with what's within our ability. And so within the past year and a half, we've been fortunate that we've been able to have more resources to hire like a program director and bring on some full-time music instructors, which is really essential for like, you know, people retention and having the same people that are working with the kids to keep, you know, those relationships intact and programs that we've been designing and developing and instruments, partners that are donating, you know, tens of thousands of dollars of instruments every year. So I feel like we are at this like new stage of Rock to the Future where we're able to take on more partnerships but still deliver really like high quality, consistent programming. And you know, to your point, it like makes sense. It's like, of course, like youth love playing music. They want to be able to write music and perform it with their friends and learn an instrument, learn music production. And if we were like, hey, come on in here and like let's do homework together or whatever, then You know, I don't think people would be showing up. But if it's like, hey, come on, like we can like show you music production, you can write your own music, you can perform at professional venues, you can record at professional studios. And hey, while we're doing that, like let's go visit Temple University and you can see like their media lab. Let's go visit like Harcum. Let's go visit, wherever they're interested in visiting.
Because I mean, that's an experience that all three of us had as young people. Like, yeah, we did not hang out with our friends and do homework. We hung out with our friends in garages and basements, and like that's what we did. And that these kids can do it, and even be able to do it at a level higher than we were able to do it at that age. Like, we weren't playing venues, you know, that were like the equivalent of World Cafe Live or anything like that when we were in high school. I certainly wasn't.
I comment like all the time on like the equipment that our students receive. Because like when I got my first drum set in high school, it was like super beginner entry level, and the cymbals I think were like $40, which is really cheap for cymbals. It's what my family could afford though at that time. So I was very lucky to have that. But they felt like plastic. So now, you know, the stuff we're getting, we're able to give these kids, they're like real solid wood drum sets and like super nice, like Zildjian and Sabian cymbals. I'm a drummer, so I don't know. They get nice guitars and like whatever and all that.
Some of those guitars that I played with in Kensington, there were a couple of them that I played. I was like, I like this one. Like I want this one.
Yeah, and they should feel special, and they deserve that opportunity to have something that's really nice. But I think that's another definite bonus is like for the teens that are in our Kensington and Germantown programs, they get their own instrument and they get to keep that. And sometimes they want to come in and switch it out for something different or something, yeah, different sound or whatever it is that they want to switch it out for. So it's really cool that we like can do that. And they come into the office and Josh will sit down and he'll show them like the 20 guitars that we might have available that just were donated or repaired, and they can come in and test them out. They can take one. And then I don't know. It's really awesome.
How has the response of like, I'm not even talking about the charitable community and all that, but just like the general music community, like other artists, studios, record labels, venues, things like that. Like how those relationships have been, it seems to be as important as, you know, all the other stuff that go into, you know, keeping a thriving nonprofit on track.
I know that people will hear this like, you know, a month from now, but on Friday, they're releasing like a music video and a song that the students have had an opportunity to record with Kevin Bacon of the,
oh, he, cool.
He has a band called the Bacon Brothers. So, yeah, sometimes these opportunities and connections that you have lead to the kids performing a song with Kevin Bacon and to meet, you know, somebody famous like him. And like every year we bring the kids into a recording studio to record their song in a professional studio. You know, that's a goal of the after school program. And I think it's important to provide those kind of experiences and opportunities, perform at a professional venue, be in a professional recording studio, you know, because those are the things that the kids look back on, you know, later in life when you talk to them about their experiences. I mean, even when we were in, we used to work with, well, we're starting to back up, but we used to have like a band that, you know, would perform a lot of different events called the House Band. We would take them to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame every year. And, you know, that was some of the kids' favorite locations because they've never been outside of Philadelphia. You know, they like have an appreciation for Ohio that is very surprising. I've never heard beside the students, you know. You know, anybody else love something like that?
The Philadelphia music community and art scene is like super generous and just so community driven. I think it was in 2010 in our first year, the students sang on a hop along song, which is so awesome.
Oh, yeah, that's
so they're
right.
On Laments, yeah. Which is like such an amazing opportunity. And Francis and the band, and Joe, you know, who's also an Algernon, like, they've been huge supporters. Our students have got to do a original song that they wrote with Chill Moody collaborating on it, which is so awesome.
You open up for the Dead Milkmen.
Right. Right. We've had the Dead Milkmen at events, and then the Giving Groove, which is also has been super generous to Rock to the Future, and all of the proceeds from like the new Dead Milkmen record are going to Rock to the Future, and West Philadelphia Orchestra also put out a record through them, which is going to our organization. So it's really, and Philly Music Fest, which I know we were talking about earlier, such an incredible, it's really amazing. Like how Philly, you know, no matter what folks may be doing with their day jobs or with their art and their creativity, like their willingness to support our organization, and then also, you know, other crucial arts and music organizations in the city.
I definitely agree with your point that like Philadelphia is already just a very, the music world here is already very community driven. It's not so much professional driven. And when I say that, I don't mean that the quality of music is not professional, but it's not an industry town. We're not New York. We're not Los Angeles. We're not Nashville. When people get together, they want to do things together. And you guys offer a way for people to do things together.
Yeah, I love Philadelphia. How small also like the arts community can be, and people are so like interconnected.
Well, I mean, when you said the kids got to sing on a hop-along song, Josh, you went to school with like Joe and Kyle from the Headroom. So like there was your avenue in right there. It wasn't like, oh, let's approach this band that, you know, is kind of on the rise. These were your friends like all already. And that's like the best thing about Philadelphia is when you start working with people, you're just like, oh, we just would have done this anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, Francis was our roommate too for a bit, you know. So we.
I want to give. I would love to give like a little plug for an event that we do annually. So, sure. Because the one thing that I love about us also is like we provide these opportunities to have great local artists collaborate with our students. So every year we have the Music for All Ball. It'll be at World Cafe Live, April 29th, 2023. We have some performers already confirmed. So we have Suge Daniels.
Oh, I know Suge. Yeah, she and I are neighbors.
Oh, that's so funny. Like, even this.
Again, Philadelphia. Like, it's just, yeah. Oh, that's so great. And Suge is so, oh, God. Like, that's a perfect partnership right there because she's so positive and
pumped for that. Yeah. And then the Bacon Brothers are also going to be performing. But every year we do this event. So like every year we've had the chance to have some type of collaboration with different artists that are just willing to give their time and work with the students and perform some songs together. And it really kind of opens up like additional like that network and that sphere of people that are connected to the organization. Because again, folks just willing to get involved, give their time, write some really amazing tunes with some Philadelphia kids.
I want to kind of go out on the thought or the idea. Like, so you're going into 2023, obviously Music for All Ball is on. The after school program is still rolling. You've expanded the mobile music lab. You're doing things with kids in the system. Are there other things coming forward in 2023 you guys are super excited about?
More mobile sites. you know, like Jess was saying, you know, that we brought on some of the instructors full time, so they're doing mobile during the day, then after school. We've actually had to hire more people just for our mobile programs, which is really awesome. So so more mobile sites are definitely in the future. And I think a big goal of the next couple months is defining ways of like that pipeline from the Juvenile Justice Center to re-entering into our programs and you know, kind of breaking that cycle, I think is really important a goal. So those are the two things that I can see. Jess might have like 20 other goals too.
So we have like our two really comprehensive after school programs in Kensington and Germantown. And we have kids, young people. I call them kids, but
I call everyone under 30 a kid. Yeah.
But so, you know, we have these teens that it takes them an hour and a half on public transportation, three modes of public trans from Southwest Philly to get to Kensington. And the greatest barrier to participation is distance for sure. So, we would love to be able to open up other really robust after-school programs like we have in Kensington and Germantown in the West or Southwest Philadelphia area. So looking at different funding opportunities to be able to do that. And we're also planning on transitioning our team member who is in like the social work space into a full-time position, because really there just is such a need. The team member, she works a lot within restorative practices and social emotional learning growth and helping to design, trauma safety plans and communication. I just think about like when I was a teen, it was so hard to self-regulate and I was always exploding at everything. And having someone that can help you really process those emotions and learn how to de-escalate and resolve conflict is so important. Particularly, you know, we're seeing a lot of violence in the city. So one of our big, our biggest initiative is like, how can we use these different programs, our funding, our resources to develop our programs to support the needs of the city and the needs of the communities and the needs of the students.
What else do you guys still need? I mean, besides money, like, cause you always need money, like, I mean, and instruments, but I mean, like going forward, I mean, you've got all this set, obviously there's a whole apparatus at work that keeps Rock to the Future, floating. And that's great. But like nonprofits always need more, even the seemingly the most successful, best known names and things like that. Like you always need more. What are things that you as an organization still need?
Volunteers are always great. So we can use volunteers and there's no music experience that's required. We have, you know, non-music related volunteer opportunities. And we also have committees. So for folks that aren't interested in necessarily coming into the programs and working directly with the students, but maybe have professional skills or community connectors that want to support our outreach and our events, then those are super necessary. We really utilize and rely a lot on volunteer support. Instruments for sure. We do have some primary instrument partners. I want to give a shout out to like Hungry for Music because they are incredible and have really helped us grow our programs. But with the program growth, we can always use more instruments. I'll also note meals. We get meals contributed to us through the School District of Philadelphia. They're donated. They're not the favorite by the students. They're pretty disgusting.
They're all right.
It's edible.
I've eaten a couple of them when I was helping out at Kensington in Germantown. Like I said, they're not, they won't harm you. They are food.
They are food. Yeah. You know, it's when we do our feedback groups with our students and we ask them, what are the things that you want to see changed? It's we want better meals. So we've been spending more out of our budget to buy better food for the programs. But if there's folks out there that are interested in either, you know, providing food or providing food at a discount, then that would be super also.
I remember when Josh would get subs or pizza, the kids would lose their minds. Yeah.
And we try to do healthy things too, but I mean, you know, to be honest, like pizza is the most like cost efficient and kids love it. But if there are, again, folks out there that want to support that need, Josh, I mean, partnerships also. So like, you know, if people work in or know folks that work in the spaces of food, physical and mental health, housing, youth development, things that we can connect our youth and our families with, higher education, trade programs. Those are all the types of things like that we really can use to, again, provide support systems, provide resources.
Yeah. And some of the sites have like people come into sometimes, like even if you're working in a music trade that, you know, like a sound engineer or something, somebody that's like lively that would want to come in and talk about their career, you know, because everyone that's in the programs there, you know, to meet other people and have friends, but also, you know, because they love music. So people that work in the music industry, I think is a really cool opportunity for them to talk to somebody about their job.
Well, it sounds like you guys are on track to have a fantastic 2023, like all the previous 12 years. So I wish you all the best. Not even wish. I know you will all have the best because you've been doing it for this long. And that's what I wanted to do with these sort of things that I'm doing this month, is because people associate the end of the year with charitable giving, not just on the corporate level, but on the personal level. And people at the holidays tend to think about these things more. So I'm just trying to get more people in front of you and you in front of more people so you can keep doing what you're doing. Like I said, I've only been sort of gone from you guys for about a year, but the things that you've been doing in that year, like I was like, oh wow, like all this happened.
And so we do have I think this is going to air in December. So, you know, we do have our end of the year giving campaign. We have a $50,000 match right now. So if we can raise $50,000, then a donor is going to match that entirely. So if folks are interested in getting involved with, you know, a financial contribution, they can do that on our website, rocktothefuture.org.
Yeah. And there's all different levels on there too. Everything from as low to $5, $10, $20 up to whatever you got.
You got it. Yeah. Thank you so much for taking a look at that and for this opportunity. This is super cool.
Yeah. Thanks again for asking us and having us on. It really flew by. I can't believe it's been an hour.
I know. That's how it goes. That's how it goes. Well, thanks so much, guys. I appreciate
it. Yeah, thank
it.
You.
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Josh and Jess of Rock to the Future, for talking, for making an outstanding organization. Go to rocktothefuture.org for more information, and that's where you can donate, like I said at the top of the show. You can donate as an individual. There's workplace giving programs, and of course, there's always instrument donation. I was just dropping something off at the Rock to the Future warehouse a few weeks ago, and they've got fantastic instruments, and they're all provided free to the students. No cost to the students, no cost to the families at all. And this is some primo stuff in there too. I was sitting around with Josh playing a bunch of different guitars, just being like, these are so great. I can't believe you're just going to give them away to these kids. But of course, that's what they do. That's outstanding. It's awesome to get your first guitar, piano, drum set, bass, what have you. It's cool to get that when you're that age. Anyway, good work at Rock to the Future, rocktothefuture.org. Don't forget about the end-of-year $50,000 match. If they hit their goal by the end of the year, an anonymous donor is going to match them $50,000. You can also head over to the Giving Groove record label. A lot of their releases benefit Rock to the Future. The artists get to choose the charity. The Dead Milkmen's Metaphysical Graffiti, which is out on Giving Groove Records right now, that's a reissue. That's benefiting Rock to the Future. And also the West Philly Orchestra and Rummy Kitchen project, the Cosmic Freak project, that's benefiting Rock to the Future as well. If you remember, I talked to Greg Mervine from West Philly Orchestra back on episode 252, not that long ago. So these are all the outstanding ways that you can donate and support Rock to the Future. And that's going to do it for this week. Thank you so much for listening. My name is Dan Drago. It's 25 o'clock, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. Until next time, take care of yourselves.